Hello again, everyone. I'm Ariel Helwani in Las Vegas, here to cover UFC 216. But this afternoon, we have the absolute pleasure of speaking to Dr. Jeffrey Davidson. If you're a longtime UFC fan, there's a very good chance you have seen this man at a UFC event or two. If not, at the very least, you've heard his name. He's referenced all the time by the likes of UFC President Dana White and other UFC officials. This afternoon, though, we're talking to him about the events that took place late Sunday here in Las Vegas. Dr. Jeffrey Davidson is not only the chief medical physician for the UFC, he's had that position for over a decade, but for the last 20 plus years, he's been a practicing doctor here in Las Vegas, Nevada, at the Valley Hospital here. He's the chief medical doctor in the emergency department. Did I get that right, Mr. Davidson?
You did.
Okay. Thank you. It's a lot to digest, and I really appreciate your time here today. It has been, a trying 72 or so hours in this community, and you have been at the forefront of it all. So let's start at the beginning. Let's start Sunday evening. Where were you at around 10 p.m. Pacific time when you got the call that this was going on just on the Las Vegas Strip, a couple miles from here?
Sunday evening, I was at home, probably like everyone else, getting ready to kind of get ready for nighttime Sunday night. I was notified by one of my office directors that there was a shooting, possibly a mass shooting with multiple victims, and that we were going to initiate what's called a mass casualty incident or a disaster drill. Initially didn't know what she was talking about, as many people didn't. She said, turn on your TV. At that time, I did. I started to witness what everyone else in the world was witnessing. Quickly got into, I call it doctor mode, and headed down to the emergency department. Was there very quickly, and when I walked in, it was a pretty horrific sight. Multiple victims had been brought in both by the EMS system, which is the ambulance system, and also by private vehicle. People were just being brought in by anyone that could pick someone up and bring them into the area hospitals. At that time, my understanding was the multiple trauma emergency departments that we have in the community were at capacity, and that the patients were also being dispersed to all the other area emergency departments. And we're in proximity to one of the trauma centers, and so we were catching multiple patients coming over to our facility at that time.
And for those that don't know, how far away is the Valley Hospital from the Mandalay Bay?
It's really down the freeway. It's about a 10 to 15 minute distance by ambulance or private vehicle drive, so it's fairly close.
And so you get there at around 11 or so, 11:30, and there's already a horrific scene. As you said, there's already a ton of people injured who have already arrived from the shooting.
As I walked in, like you said, multiple victims kind of throughout the hallways, in gurneys, everywhere. I was very proud that multiple physicians had already been coordinated in addition to me to get there. I had multiple ED physicians with me. I had my ED nursing staff, which had doubled in its capacity, multiple ED ancillary help, support techs, phlebotomists, all the people you would need to really handle that type of mass casualty incident. At the same time, I was able to get in touch with general surgeons, specialists like ear, nose, and throat specialists, vascular surgeons, cardiovascular surgeons, and they all, without even thinking, came right into the emergency department to help us with all the specific injuries we were seeing.
Considering the fact that you work in the emergency department, you are used to high-pressure situations, but when you walk into a scene like that, how do you start? Where do you begin? What do you do? What's the first step?
For me that evening, it was, as I was taking kind of scene command of the emergency department, I had all the emergency department physicians who had already begun to triage and see what we call the appropriate order from the most severely injured to we thought the least injured. And as they were seeing those patients and beginning the resuscitation measures such as IV fluids, hanging blood products, stabilizing hemorrhaging wounds, I would get the report from them, and then I would decide who would be able to go to the operating rooms first based on the criticality of their injuries. So you begin with the beginning, and you just start with what's thought to be the most severely injured that needed the operating rooms the quickest, and you just keep working down and you keep repeating back. And as patients' conditions changed, things had to be changed, and sometimes patients had to be moved into the operating rooms quickly, and sometimes we were able to continue resuscitation efforts in the emergency department.
Obviously, this was the deadliest mass shooting in American history. Have you ever even remotely been in a situation like this where it's just a constant stream of people that you have to work on?
No. I mean, 20 years plus of active, you know, emergency department work here. I trained Phoenix, Arizona, very busy emergency department training with a large population in Phoenix. I think you always prepare when you're an emergency department physician. This is, a lot of us call it doctor mode, and we prepare for a disaster, and we actually do several disaster drills. But I don't think anything prepares you for an event that occurred like occurred this last Sunday.
In the span of 24 or so hours, how many people do you think that you treated?
I think some of the numbers have been coming back to me. You know, it always seems more at the time. I think the other thing to remember for the public is at the time this event occurred, all the emergency departments in the area were already actively taking care of their emergencies that had already arrived. So, for example, the emergency departments were fairly full with emergency department patients. So when this next infusion of a large number of victims came in, it really took capacities to a new level. I think from what I've been told at our facility, we did multiple operations. We did gunshot wounds to the chest, the abdomen, the extremities, to the face. We had over 30 patients at our facility, and multiple other Valley Health System hospitals did the same. I know the Sunrise System was exceptional in their trauma response and had over 200 patients at that facility. So I think collectively the community came together, and I think every hospital, by doing something, collectively helped the entire community.
You're a great doctor. You're also a human being. Your father, you have two boys, right? And you know, you're seeing this unfold, and I'm sure as time goes by, people are trickling in, and it's very emotional, and people are looking for loved ones. How are you able to separate the human and the emotions that you're feeling? This is your town, right? You're very close to this community, and trying to focus on the task at hand.
I've been in Vegas a long time. I love Las Vegas. I think it's a great city. It has a lot of opportunity for community, for family. You know, it was very hard. I think the hardest part was what you touched on, Ariel, that I have two young teenage boys, and I kept thinking, you know, they're out at these types of events. And my heart not only went out to the victims, but it went out to the families. There were a lot of very distraught family members and friends walking around just trying to get a little bit of information, and it was slow to them because the process was to care for the patient and then try and communicate as fast as we could. But it was difficult. My heart really went out to all the, not just the victims, but the families of the victims, the friends of the victims. And I think the hardest thing was to continue the communication to them, even the following day and the following day.
How long did you work? So this is, 11, midnight, 1. How long did you work before you were, released from your shift, if you want to call it a shift? I mean, it's a pretty long one, I would imagine.
It was a very long night, and obviously through the morning hours. I got to the hospital about 11 p.m. that night and stayed till 4 o'clock the next day.
Wow.
Went home and came back at 6 a.m. the next morning.
Wow.
And then worked another 9-10 hours. I don't know if it's how long you worked, but I think it was that evening and that morning, it was more the adrenaline and the mode of doing all you can. And again, boy, I just want to emphasize, it wasn't just doctor or doctors, it was everyone. The nurses that I worked with, I couldn't be more proud of. The technicians, the staff, everyone. And, also just you have to be looking at those patients and realizing as many patients as there were and as injured as they were and as afraid as they were, they all kept very calm. Mm-hmm. It was an amazing thing to witness that the actual victims were so calm. And I think that's a tribute to the community and the hospitals, that they were confident and they knew they were in good care. And I think that's a tribute to the staff providing that sense of confidence to them.
How extensive were some of these surgeries that you performed? I mean, is this of the highest order? Is this, you're talking about gunshot wounds to the face, right? This is pretty extensive stuff.
It was very extensive. I trained in an emergency department that had trauma and burn centers, and so I've been exposed to much in my career and my training. I think some of the injuries we saw Sunday night, and I'm sure all the ED physicians in the community saw, were as severe as we all see. This was a very high caliber, gun used, bullets were everywhere, and victims came in with injuries everywhere. I mean, literally face, chest, abdomen, torso, extremities. So it was horrific, And I think the only console that I have is that there were so many great physicians that responded. And, you know, at every facility we have different levels of success based on the injuries. But I think as I've begun to get information back from many different sources that there has been improvement with many patients.
Do you have any idea how many patients came to the hospital in that, you know, 24-hour stretch? Would you have any idea?
You know, right now I don't have that number, but what's another number to know is it's not just the gunshot wounds that we also cared for. There were many patients that had trampling injuries. You know, when you had 20,000-plus individuals enjoying that concert, and as you watch the videos that you've all seen this week, you can see they all exited very quickly. And in that, some people were, you know, accidentally stepped on or fell to the ground or whatnot. So there were also other injuries that were secondary injuries to just the crowd exiting so quickly.
Do you have any idea how many have been released since Monday?
I was just in the intensive care unit this morning, and all of our intensive care unit patients are doing, they're stable.
Okay.
That's as much as I'd like to comment on that. Okay. And then many patients have been released from the hospital that were not in the intensive care unit.
It is Thursday, so we're 4 days removed, a little less than 4 days. What is the vibe like in the hospital now? Does it still feel like a high intense situation, or is it easing a little bit?
You know, you touched on a thought that's going to take a long time to understand. You know, the emotional aspect of this is what's going to probably start to kick in about today, like you said. How every individual victim's family, and all the providers begin to deal with the mental aspect of this is going to be everyone's case by case. I imagine there'll be a lot of people that will have to deal with what happened in different ways. There's all types of different support structure out there now that has been provided to the community by different organizations and different people, but it's going to be difficult. I think the memory of what occurred will take some time for everyone to understand and try and deal with, and I think that's going to be the difficult issue now, is how to mentally have everyone try and move forward the best they can.
Have you had a chance to digest it all, to have a moment, you know, to yourself and to allow this to sink in?
You know, I've had a few moments. I think the week has been so time-consuming that I really haven't just sat by myself and thought what we did as a group, what the community did. I think, you know, in the future, that I'll have that moment. And it'll be a difficult moment to deal with, I think, at that time.
One thing that I read, and I don't know if this affects you in your position, but a lot of the victims did not have IDs, maybe didn't have their... Did that make things difficult for the group, especially when people are trying to find, you know, a loved one?
I think you kind of answered the question perfectly. You know, caring for the patients was straightforward. Everyone got a specific kind of what's called a triage number, and we cared immediately for all the patients. And when you get that big of an influx of patients at all the facilities, that's the system you put in place. But I think to your question, it must have been incredibly stressful for families and loved ones to say, which hospital did my loved one go to? Where are they? Are they okay? How do I even find them? When you listen to the victims' stories this week, everyone lost their phones, they lost their ID, they lost their wallet. So, you know, and many of these people, as you've already accounted, weren't transported by ambulance. They were transported by just private vehicle. So I don't even know if many people even knew where they were going and or who was taking them to the area hospital they ended up at.
We don't live here, got here yesterday to cover UFC 216, and I noted yesterday that there's a somber feeling. I mean, this is usually a very festive town, especially when we're here for a UFC event.
Right.
This is a place where people go to forget their troubles, but it's a different vibe, and understandably so. As someone who lives here, how would you describe what it's like? Just, you know, we're on the strip, you're in the community, so you have that contact with families and your neighbors. What's it been like for you?
I think you were accurate. It's very, it's quiet. It's a calm, it's people trying to understand the horrific, senseless acts that just occurred. I think it will take some time for the community. I hope the community continues to move forward, but I think it will take time for all the community to adjust to what just happened, and like I said, to deal with it. I think it's something we will understand as a human race, and we'll move forward and we'll become stronger and better, as we all hope. But you're right, it's a little bit of a less vibrant time period right now for us.
Long before the Raiders and the Golden Knights, the UFC was the hometown team here.
Right.
Dana White is a very proud resident of Las Vegas, and he's sort of a defiant character as well. And so I had no doubt that he would proceed with the show and show everyone that, you know, Vegas is very strong. He also announced that they'd be donating $1 million to the patients and the victims. And so I'm just wondering, as someone who's been affiliated with the UFC for over a decade, you worked for the Nevada Athletic Commission, ringside physician, worked in boxing. I mean, you're very entrenched in the combat sports world here. Your reaction when you heard what Dana White said and the donation as well?
You know, I expected nothing less. I knew Dana White. He is all heart. I knew that both himself, his family, and then his UFC family, I knew they would come to the assistance of the community. That he's always done that. The UFC has always done that. They donate in so many different ways. It's not just monetary. It's time. It's the actual athletes. There's a lot of different ways, but Dana has always given out to this community. He's probably poured as much into this community as anyone I can think of. So I would expect nothing less. I always know that if something happens in this community that adversely affects it, you can count on Dana White, you can count on UFC. They're going to be there to support the community always.
Will you be working the event on Saturday?
I will be there. Wow. I will be there. I think, as you said, the right thing to do is continue to move forward. At the same time, we don't want to forget what happened. We don't want to forget the patients we're taking care of. But I think the right thing to do is trying to continue to move forward.
And do you, like, if it just in a situation like this, do you at some point take a break? Like, you're not a robot, right? You're going to have a moment where this is going to really hit you. How do you deal with that? Because you have to be, you know, at 100%. You're doing a very important job. How do you plan that out?
Well, I haven't planned that out.
Okay.
I think
not the time.
Yeah, I think the right thing for me to do right now is just continue to. I have responsibilities to the hospital, to the emergency medical system here in the community, and I have responsibilities to the UFC. And I think the right thing to do is continue to be, to work for all the organizations I work for. I enjoy them, and I think the responsibility is to continue to work for them. When I do get a moment in a week, it'll be a quiet moment where I think back on what we just came through.
Final thing, is there anything that the people out there can do? I know that a lot of civilians came and donated blood. Just wondering if there's anything at this point, from your vantage point, that you've seen that anyone at home who wants to help is able to do?
I would compliment the entire community and everyone. You touched on it, but the outpouring at the Red Cross blood bank donations was amazing. The outpouring of community businesses and residential that came to all of the hospitals with donations of food and water and supplies for not just the medical group, but for families. The outpouring from the area hotels that provided rooms and things has been amazing. I think as a community, everyone has continued to do a tremendous amount, and I think all we can all try and do is kind of learn from this and move forward and do the right thing so that hopefully nothing like this ever happens again.
Thank you very much, Doctor. I really appreciate this. I know you're so busy, so for you to come out and talk to us, really appreciate it, and thank you for everything that you've done for the community over the past few days. Honor to talk to you today.
Thank you. Thank you very much.